still marvel to this day how well he laid it out on the whiteboard, the processes, including facts about, you know, what's the hydrometer supposed to read at this point, and you let it sit in the fermentation phase until you reach a certain degree of alcohol. And he had all of the facts, and it just laid it out in a spectacular form. Hold on to that as long as you possibly can.
Yeah.
That's all I'm
saying. That's
another
stuff after this to do. Drinking. Yeah, no, that is going to be okay. In case you didn't understand
the subtle picture.
Yeah.
Let's go.
All right, everybody. For those of you I don't know, I'm Katie, and I'm a data scientist in the Innovation Center here at Clearwater. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the science in data science. We hear a lot about the data in data science, and that's for a very good reason. If you were at Jason's talk earlier, you heard how you spend a lot of your time just munging data, processing data. And your ability to train a good model is largely related to your ability to get good data. But there's this other word in the field title, science. And that's what I'd like to focus on today. So why am I so interested in science? Turns out I'm actually a lapsed molecular biologist over here. This is me at home in the lab. So this is actually what I spent like the last 10 years doing. I went to grad school for chemical and systems biology. And studied proteomics there. So I was looking at small chemical modifications to proteins that happen naturally using some really fancy tools like mass spectrometers. Big words, guys. So that was a lot of fun. And then at my last job, I was working with a company that designed DNA sequencing assays. So I got to play with lots of fancy equipment there too. But okay, that's all fine and dandy. My career path took a hard left turn. Why am I up here comparing biology and data science? So it's actually a fairly comfortable transition. For one thing, this scene, fairly familiar actually. This is Mark in his native habitat. Yes, he knew I was taking the photo. He also knew what it was going to be used for. But the idea being that it is sometimes maybe not the most orderly workspace. We can make some stereotypical jokes about, you know, lots of monitors and some headphones and things like that. But lab, also, sort of really disorganized workspace. This is a lab I spent some time in, and apparently we don't throw away our PCR plates after we finish experiments, and we pile some pipette tip boxes dangerously on the top of shelves for a few years. It's a similar environment, very familiar. The next thing that's sort of familiar is occasionally questionable documentation practices. This is a project I was looking into recently and hadn't looked at it all and went to go try and figure out what it was about and got about this far. Looks like the person responsible for this commit actually decided to skip this talk today, so I will not call that person out. But this is my documentation practice for all of grad school. Actually, these notebooks, these ones right here, very familiar. And all of my notes, all of my work from all of grad school is still in these paper notebooks, probably on the same shelf I left them on several years ago, with really no ability for me to go back and search them or remember anything I did, or for anyone else to really understand what's in them either. Then there's the maybe stereotypical, but not always accurate, clothing choices. whether that be slippers at work or lab coats. You'll notice I wasn't wearing a lab coat in that picture earlier. Surprising. Then there's the free food black hole. We had one of these in grad school too. It's amazing what happens if you take snacks and just leave them on a table. But in all seriousness, there are some differences, right? And that's that in data science, your data might look something a little bit like this. And I was used to data that looked a little bit something like this. This is DNA run on a gel. I have no idea what it is because, see, again, questionable documentation practices. But I found it on my grad school computer, so it's something important, probably. So again, back to this question of why am I up here comparing biology and data science? And the answer is that they're really both a systematic way of understanding a process, modeling that process by asking questions, and then answering them using data. It's just that the data looks a little bit different. And this right here, that's science. My earliest science hero. Yep, that's the scientific method right there. And I sometimes cringe when I see these words because it sounds like something that a middle school science teacher spent a lot of time talking about. There was probably some state-mandated tests that, you know, you had to write up an experiment in a certain way where you had a hypothesis stated in a very particular form, and then you had to have, you know, your description of what you were going to do and your results written up in a very particular way. And I think that in some ways we do science a disservice by teaching it in a way where that seems like this formal, cringy thing that we're not gonna come back to. Because actually, it's an incredibly powerful method, and what a lot of lab scientists do actually looks remarkably similar to what you may have learned in middle school and high school science. And in fact, scientific conferences often feature posters that look a lot like science fair posters, because it's the same process. So, all right, I'm gonna talk about science. So first, I'm gonna talk about what does it mean to call data science science. Then I'm gonna talk a little bit about what it means to do science, some ideas on ways that you might go about applying this idea of science to data science. And then finally, what do you gain from taking a scientific approach to data problems? All right, so we're gonna talk first about what does it mean to call something science. And I'm gonna approach this in the context of this question that a lot of people in the room have, which is like, why are you calling yourself a scientist versus an engineer versus an analyst? You know, aren't the scientists just the, super idealistic people who just don't have build requirements and can go off and do whatever experiment they want? Yes, Lauren, that was from you. That's cool. So I think the question can be, you know, what is your focus? Are you calculating something? Are you building something? Are you understanding something? And I would argue that these things don't have to be viewed as separate things. In order to build something, you have to understand something about the processes underlying how you're going to put that thing together. I would say that the scientific focus is probably more on the understanding side of this framework. There was an interesting podcast I was listening to from this podcast called Linear Digressions. And they have a talk called Putting the Science in Data Science, and I swear I didn't see that talk title before I put mine together. But they had an interesting discussion about this idea of science being a process of discovering something that is there to be discovered, and engineering being this process of building something, and you will get there at some point. You will build the thing, but that in science, you can only discover things that are actually there to be discovered, and that sometimes this can cause conflicts in terms of people's expectations when you put someone from a scientific background on an engineering team. They're like, well, what do you mean you don't have an answer and you can't do that thing? It's like, well, that it's not possible. Might be a scientifically valid answer. I don't know. I'll see what the data says. I think another important concept in looking at something as a science is understanding the role of models. There's a famous George Box quote that's, all models are wrong, but some are useful. Is there anyone in this room other than Dana who wants to tell me what this is all about up here? Yeah, so we have Newtonian versus relativistic momentum. And I think the point I'm trying to illustrate here is that unless you are going faster than any human has ever gone before, you probably don't care about that model. But we know this one's wrong, but it makes useful predictions, so we're gonna use it. And that is essentially the role that models take on in science. They're a tool that makes predictions, and we test those predictions. If those predictions turn out to be useful, then we can use that model. And that's true in laboratory science. That's also basically what data science is all about, building models that make useful predictions. All right, so moving on to what does it mean to do science? And in this section, I'm gonna talk a little bit about some of the things that I've found in the lab, and now more recently on my computer, that are useful thought frameworks when approaching a scientific question. And that's that science is essentially just this iterative process over and over and over again between hypothesis and experiment, hypothesis and experiment. And it's really having an idea of how something might work and then testing to see if your idea is right. If you're right, cool. If you're wrong, okay, we'll change the hypothesis. That's essentially part of the mindset, is this ability to constantly update your model. So let's look at hypothesis first in this cycle. A hypothesis is essentially a testable model. You can't really pull a strong hypothesis out of this cycle, which is to say that if your hypothesis isn't testable, you can't really do anything about it. And so maybe you should work on making it testable. What makes it testable is your ability to do experiments that look at the predictions that it makes. So I'm gonna talk about some principles that can help you actually build a testable hypothesis. And while we do that, I'm gonna use a working example that has nothing to do with data science or molecular biology. Well, maybe my personal functional molecular biology. But all right, so our working fun model here is that a cup of coffee will make everything better. We'll come back to that idea. All right, so the first thing a testable hypothesis should be is specific. All right, so this is in part to make the hypothesis testable and in part to understand the constraints of the problem that you're working with. So really when you're talking about a hypothesis, it's pretty unlikely that you're gonna be making a bold statement about the way the universe works in every conditions, everywhere, at every speed, at every time and size scale. Probably not. So I would encourage you to put some constraints on the thing that you're proposing, your hypothesis. When are you saying that your model will be applicable? And that's important because you can't test every conceivable corner of the universe, but you can test a model under certain conditions. I say to make it specific also to help make it more testable in the sense that if you can't test a model directly, decompose it a little bit. This idea of decomposition might be a fairly familiar one to some of the software engineers in the room, but think about what would need to be true for that model to also be true. What would be consistent with the model? What would be consequences of the model? And can you test those consequences? Maybe you can't test the model directly, but if you can show that the consequences don't hold, you need to go back and readjust your model. You can kind of think of the idea as, if this hypothesis is true, then it follows that, and maybe you can test that follow. I've heard, again, back to this idea of engineering versus science, and I really do think that they are two sides of the same coin. And this is just a paraphrase. Well, I don't do science because I have constraints I have to work within. And I think that really all scientists are working within constraints. Maybe your constraints aren't quite as specific, but you're not always looking for a global maxima. You're looking for a local workable maxima, and maybe your constraints are the time within which you're working, or the material that you have to spend, or the hours you have to spend on this. And that's an acceptable specification. All right, so we're gonna go back to our working hypothesis here. And we're gonna go from a cup of coffee will make everything better. That's not specific. I can't affect everything in the world. It's not on my to-do list this week. So we're gonna settle for making my day better. We'll progress from there. All right, so the next thing a hypothesis should be is knowledge-based. And when I say this, I mean that it should be based on what you already know and what other people already know. This seems like a fairly basic point, but I do think that sometimes when the scientific method is introduced as a formal framework, people tell you, well, you can't ask a hypothesis as a question, so I want you to make a statement about what you think is going to happen. So just take your question and pick an outcome, and that's a hypothesis. Technically, I guess, but it's not a very strong one. And I think that there are a couple of things that you gain from really focusing on making your hypothesis driven by existing knowledge. One is you're likely to conduct much better experiments within the context of what is already known about the problem. You may discover you don't have to conduct a certain experiment by doing research about your problem. I think the other thing is that you need to understand your working model well enough to predict what you're going to see as an output. If you don't have any idea what your output is going to be, you're going to have a really hard time setting up an appropriate experiment. If you don't know what order of magnitude your response is, you may not pick an appropriate instrument to measure it. And if you can't, predict how tweaking this parameter might come out the other end in your model, maybe you would benefit from the mental process of reviewing that model. It also helps because then if you have an unexpected result, you know it's an unexpected result. And that's great because then either you've learned your model is wrong or your understanding is wrong. And those are both really useful points because then you're learning something new. I'll caution here about confirmation bias. Like, I don't want you to not doubt when you get expected results, but at least have thought about what you might expect to come out of the situation. All right, so we're gonna go from a cup of coffee makes Katie's day better. Maybe this is a good working hypothesis, I don't know. Would anyone in the room like to chime in as to why this is a bad hypothesis?
How do you measure a better day?
Okay, definitely.
Coffee.
Yeah? Yeah?
So, plenty of cups of coffee, but maybe
Katie
drinking that cup of coffee would make it better?
Yeah, staring at it. Actually, so here's the thing. In my case, I don't like coffee. I really don't like coffee. And maybe my team knows me well enough to know that. And so for them, that would be some knowledge that they could put into this model that would make it a better hypothesis. So we're going to switch to a cup of tea for now. All right, so kind of getting to the point that some of you made, for a hypothesis to be testable, it has to be measurable, which is before you even get around to conducting an experiment, think about what you're going to measure on the other side. How are you going to translate this phenomena that you're looking at into something that you can compare? And I would say ideally into a number. Numbers are a lot easier to work with than qualitative descriptions, but sometimes you can't quite get there. Think about, how would you quantify this? What are the potential outcomes? What order of magnitude will they be? And how do you have the equipment to measure that effect? So going back to our working hypothesis, some people pointed out that, maybe I should drink it. What does it mean to make my day better? I don't know.
I think it's when I smile. I like to smile a lot. This is really a substantial improvement here, but we're going to go full on science here, and we're going to ask about my smile per hour rate, and we're going to say that it's going to be positively correlated with the amount of tea I've consumed that hour. My teammate pointed out that this is an entirely viable experiment because they can hack the webcam on my computer and assess my smile rate and my caffeine intake, and we'll just try not to be creeped out by that. It's cool. All right, so we've talked about hypotheses. Let's talk about experiments a little bit, because that's ultimately what a hypothesis is setting you up to do, is to test it. So the first thing is an experiment should be systematic. And what I mean about this is really take an ordered approach to the way that you test things. In my past experience in the lab, there was this common phrase of complete the matrix, which is this idea that if you have a couple of variables and you have multiple conditions per variable, you should make a matrix out of those conditions, and then you should test each of them. With very large systems, this can kind of combinatorially explode. There are some great methods out there for dealing with this. There's an entire field called design of experiment to look at how you can avoid testing all combinations. But for most experiments that people do on a day-to-day basis, and given sufficient constraints, really something like this is a great starting point for a framework of the way that you're going to approach an experiment. For biology, this would be something like, okay, I have buffer A and buffer B, and enzyme A and enzyme B, and I'm going to test those combinations. In data science, this might be something like hyperparameter tuning. I have a model, I'm going to try and see which knob settings are the best, and I'm going to go about that in a systematic way, especially considering whether or not the variables are independent. All right. The next idea is that an experiment should be controlled. And in my experience, at least in biology, the three main controls that I want to touch on are negative controls, positive controls, and normalization controls. So I'm going to walk through biology examples for these, and then we'll come back and talk about them in data science. So the first control is a negative control. And this is a sample you expect to fail. So say I'm going to amplify a bunch of DNA, and I want to prove that, like, it's the DNA I'm interested in and not just my lab mate's contamination hanging out over here on the benchtop. What do? In parallel with my sample of interest, I run a sample that just has water in it. If I wind up with a band on my gel from that sample that just has water in it, I'm going to have some words with my lab mate. But really, this is also known as a placebo. But it's this idea of having a sample that should fail. The next is a positive control. It's just the opposite. It's having a sample that should succeed. And this is to protect against systematic failure of the experiment. Let's say I run my gel and I don't see any bands. Guess my DNA didn't amplify. Or maybe I forgot to put the gel dye in and I can't actually visualize anything on that gel. Well, if I had a known sample in there, I would be able to distinguish between those possibilities. So a positive is having a sample that should succeed. Next is a normalization control. And this is just what it sounds like. It's having something in your sample that you do not expect to change and that you can compare to. This is really helpful in biology when you're making qualitative assessments of, say, gene expression. I want to say that the reason that this cell line has cancer and this cell line does not is because this cell line has a lot more of my favorite super cancer-causing protein. Well, I can put them both on the gel, but in order to demonstrate that I've actually put the same total amount of material on there, in addition to just looking for the protein I care about, I'm going to look for another protein that I don't expect to change between cell lines. And then I can demonstrate that I haven't just been all sneaky on you and loaded a whole bunch more stuff in that well. All right, So that's the idea behind these controls in molecular biology. Let's go back to data science. So there's this idea, right, my positive and negative controls, of having samples with expected outcomes. Does that sound familiar to anyone? Yeah, tests, unit tests. All right. So I had several teammates tell me that there was no way I could possibly make those exciting. Don't even try. But maybe thinking of them as scientific controls can make them slightly more palatable. I don't know. We'll work on that one. normalization is also a relevant factor, right? So if you're looking at a data set and you consider that that data set may change over time or between situations, you want to have something that you don't expect to change that you can compare back to. Normalization in data preparation is often a common manipulation that things undergo, where you divide by a mean or you subtract some background out of something, and that's the same idea of normalization. All right, so the final thing I want to talk about with experiments is reproducibility. Reproducibility is a huge thing in experimental science. It's also been in the news a lot lately due to some really unfortunate failures in reproducibility. And that's just largely linked to the fact that the incentive system in a lot of sciences does not encourage people to conduct experiments that other people have already conducted. When you're looking at factors that might influence or play a role in how you design experiments to be reproducible, one of the things that you want to look at is sample set randomization. So have you divided your samples randomly, train test split, right? In a lab, this just means, did I mix my sample up really well before I took some out to go work with? Another thing to look at is non-determinism in models. In biology, we expect some noise between things, between samples, between individuals. But there are non-deterministic processes that go on in some data science things that we work with. So a lot of models initialize with random parameters to start. And you can choose to set that seed or not. But understanding how that may influence your outcome is also going to influence how reproducible you view the experiment to be. I would say here also that there's a note of reproducibility of results versus reproducibility of the model. You may train models that actually don't necessarily have the same weights but have reproducible outcomes. And the question is just whether that satisfies your needs in that case. Finally, replicates and statistical power. In biology, we don't ever just do an experiment once. That's not reproducible. You haven't demonstrated reproducibility at all. There's this idea that you need to be able to show that something can be duplicated. And when you can do that, you also get an idea of the variability. And so then you're able to do things like put confidence intervals around the statements that you make. And you can say, well, give or take this much, I expect that this model will perform better. Or that this model behaves statistically different from this other model. And it's not just due to the initialization. All right, so that's this cycle. There's one other thing that's not shown here, but that I want to add to this cycle, because I do think that it's crucial to this process, and that is sharing. So it feeds in, really, at all stages of this cycle, this idea that science needs to be shared. And I think we have this idea of these lone geniuses, you know, over in the corner doing their experiment by themselves or working late nights in lab or, I don't know, coding with the lights off in their own little cave. But science moves forward when we communicate it to other people, when we bounce ideas off of them, when you learn about some experiment someone else did that influences yours, or when you talk to someone and they say, you know, that's an interesting idea, but I really think that there's this other technique that I read about last month that is actually a more appropriate way of conducting that experiment. There are many ways to share results. There's publication, there's conferences. There's lunchroom chats. There's staring over your lab mate's shoulder at their computer screen and saying, hey, yeah, I saw something like that too. But I would really encourage you to make science a social effort in the sense that that's really how we can make some big steps forward. All right, so finally, all right, I've given you all like my spiel on how you should do science. We've talked about some stuff that you might remember from some classes you took a while ago. If you're sick of my rant, why should you listen? Why should you take a scientific perspective? What do you gain from it? And the first thing I would propose is that it helps out with this. I think in data science, we're often faced with this total and utter deluge of data. There's so much out there. And knowing where to start in this pile is actually a huge part of the job. I think what approaching it with a scientific perspective brings is a framework. It gives you a way to structure your thoughts and your questions, your hypotheses, your experiments, to take this huge pile of data and then decompose it into really manageable problems that you can work with. And so I think that, you know, approaching it with this mindset can hopefully make this a somewhat less intimidating endeavor. All right, the next thing is just the joy of discovery. And I know that that sounds very idealistic of me and very, you know, quaint, this idea of the joy of learning something new. But you can, by taking a scientific mindset, sort of apply this tinkering and playfulness to the work that you do with data. Oh, well, I think that if I change this thing, it might have this outcome. And maybe that makes the day-to-day little bits and pieces a little bit more fun. I think maybe it can bring a different perspective or help you get out of the hole of certain things when you relate it to this larger concept of doing science. You know, debugging is essentially an experimental process, right? Something's not working the way you expected. You think you know why, so you're gonna go and you're gonna change that thing, and then you're gonna see how it changes the output. And that is a hypothesis. I think it's in this line right here. And then the experiment is running it and being like, oh, well, cool, that's where it was. Or maybe it wasn't, and well, hopefully you find it soon. But I think that it can bring a certain amount of playfulness to the everyday process of working with data, writing code, and hopefully make things a little bit more fun. Finally, science has played a huge role as a process in the way that we progress our technology. The development of technology is essentially one huge string of little tiny experiments. And whether you're talking about, you know, the data set that I'm working with or, you know, genetic data sets or anything, this is really how we go about learning about the way that the world works. If you look at little kids, it's the same way that they learn how the world works. They try something, they see what happens, and then they learn from that. And on a much grander scale, that's how we've developed, you know, this trajectory moving forward. And so if it's not too grandiose to suggest that you view yourself with a certain amount of historical unity with certain grand scientific figures out there, I do think that there's something special about being part of this process of discovering something that maybe no person has ever known before, even if it's just like a little tiny thing, and maybe no other person will ever know that again or care, but you know, and now it's a known thing. And this is how knowledge develops over the course of human history. So, thanks. Questions? Yeah?
What do you use data science for at Clearwater?
All right, so the question is, what do you use data science for at Clearwater? So I'm on the innovation team. A lot of our focus lately has been machine learning. So seeing if we can use that for certain automation processes, anomaly detection, things like natural language processing, really looking at maybe how we can automate data extraction from certain types of unstructured documents. So that's some of the things we've been playing with. So the question was, is it necessary to be able to explain the causal source of an outcome of a model for the model to be accepted? Scientifically, I don't think so. I think we would hope to explain causal things. I think that cause is much more interesting than correlation. To be useful as a predictor, it's not necessarily required. It certainly makes you feel more comfortable with it, and like you understand more where it may fail. In terms of data science specifically, I think it really depends on the field, and what the constraints are of who you're talking with and what you're operating within. You may be required in some cases to be able to explain how you made a decision and how that was based on a certain piece of data. You may have to actually explain that in human readable form at some point. In other cases, you may not be required to. I think I would always prefer to have a causal explanation. I don't know that it's always required. Lauren.
Could you give an example of a hypothesis and or experiment that you came up with on the innovation team?
All right, so the question is, can I give an example of a hypothesis or an experiment that we came up with on the innovation team? So without getting too far into the specifics on some of the projects, there was a natural language processing project that I was working on a little bit ago, and I was testing different model architectures for it. And so one of the questions we were looking at was, well, you know, which of these model architectures will perform the best? And the best is not necessarily a great quantitative question. So the way we approached that was to say, well, all right, what do we really care about? Do we care about accuracy? Do we care about rank order? Do we care about precision? Do we care about recall? And we made some decisions based on our use case as to which of those was best. And then did some testing with some, you know, statistics in there a little bit. And we're actually able to demonstrate that a specific architecture worked best for answering that question. Yeah. Yeah. So the question was about the relationship between data analytics and data engineering and data science. I think that those terms all really have very squishy definitions at the moment. I think that they all kind of get tangled in together. I do think that there is a use for a scientific approach in analytics and engineering if you're able to separate those into distinct fields. I think perhaps data science has come to mean a specific subset of these data functions that isn't necessarily that much more scientific than the other ones. We just use that term in reference to maybe someone who spends a lot of time working on machine learning models instead of building data processing pipelines or running specific calculations. So I do think that the method as a whole is applicable to all of those fields and isn't necessarily limited to the couple of things that we've encapsulated in data science. Yeah, so the question is about overfitting and p-hacking. And so with regards to overfitting, there are a lot of things you can do with your models in particular to try and avoid that. I think making sure that you have really an appropriate data set to begin with is good, and essentially understanding the constraints of that data set, right? Like not trying to make predictions about a future or a condition that is substantially different from what you have data to train on. With regards to p-hacking, that's a broad question for the scientific community at the moment. I think as a whole, really focusing on appropriate use of statistics, multiple hypothesis correction, those sort of things can help. And I think also really working on the motivation structure within science, as in not just I found something that is statistically significant and I am going to publish because that is how I get my next grant. that may also help. All right, guys, we're at time, but I would be happy to chat with anyone here. And it's not my intention to start a war between engineers and scientists or anything along those lines. But come up, talk. This is something I'm really passionate about. So.